morning students, I welcome you for another lecture on the course Microprocessors and Microcontrollers. In today's class, I am going to discuss about a concept, Serial Communication in 8051 Microcontroller. We know that any processor or controller knows parallel communication. Because every processor or a controller have a good number of data bytes. With the help of that, the processor or controller can communicate with the external. At a time, a processor or a controller can transfer or receive n number of bits if the processor or a controller have n data bytes. But coming to I/O devices side, all I/O devices didn't know parallel communication. That means all I/O devices can't accept multiple bits at a time, or they can't transfer multiple bits at a time. Such devices, what we can call is serial communication I/O devices. Some of I/O devices knows a parallel communication. Some of I/O devices knows only serial communication. Serial communication in the sense transferring of a data bit after bit or receiving of a data bit after bit. So whenever your controller or processor want to communicate with an I/O device which only knows a serial communication, one thing, either the processor or controller knows serial communication, or we have to go and incorporate some interfacing device between I/O device and our processor or a controller. Either of two things we have to do. Coming to 8051 microcontroller, it knows a parallel communication because it has 8 data bytes. With the help of that, it can transfer 8 data bits at a time, as well as it can receive 8 data bits at a time. And it has an additional feature, that was, it knows a serial communication because on 8051 we have a serial port. With the help of the serial port, our 8051 can communicate with an external I/O devices which only knows serial communication. So in this class, I am going to discuss about that serial communication in 8051. What are the different registers our 8051 can use for the serial communication, and what are the different signals are used in the serial communication. Everything I am going to discuss in this class. So, my first point is like this. 8051 microcontroller has a serial port. By using this port, 8051 can perform serial communication with the external devices. It has onboard serial port. With the help of that, our controller can communicate with external I/O devices in serial form. Right. The serial port of 8051 supports full duplex serial communication. We know that, guys, there are three types of serial communications. One is a simplex serial communication. The first one is a simplex serial communication. And number two is half duplex serial communication. And number three is full duplex serial communication. So out of these three, our 8051 supports this. Before discussing what this full duplex serial communication, first I have to go and give an idea regarding to what a simplex serial communication and what a half duplex serial communication. Listen friends, what a simplex serial communication is. Always the communication is possible only in one direction. The other direction of communication is not possible. That's what we can call a simplex communication. So listen friends, for example, our CPU always transfer data to an output device. There is no chance it can't get any data from output device to the CPU. In a similar way, always some input device transfer data to CPU. Your CPU can't send any information to input devices. So these are examples for simplex communication. And coming to number two is half duplex. That means that the communication is done in both the directions between the two stations. but it is not simultaneous. That means, for example, station 1 transfer a data to station 2. The time station 2 only receives the data, it can't transfer any data to station 1. In some other time instant, station 2 transfer a data to station 1. At the same time, station 1 can't transfer any data to station 2. That means the communication is possible between the station 1 and station 2. But it is not simultaneous. That is what we can call is half duplex. Now coming to full duplex. So it is an extension to half duplex. That is, the communication is possible between two ends or two stations simultaneously. That means a station 1 transfers a data to station 2 at the same time. Station 1 also receives the data from station 2. You know, similarly, you can go and observe from station 2 point of view. Station 2 collects the data from station 1. At the same time, station 2 transfers the data to station 1. That's what we can call is full duplex communication. So, our 8051 microcontroller will support full duplex serial communication. That means it can transmit and receive data simultaneously. Next, to perform serial communication in 8051, it has two signals. One is a TXD, means a transmitted data, and another one is called RXD. TXD means a transmitted data, and RXD means a received data. These are two signals are present in port 3 of our 8051. Once you remember, friends, a pin configuration of 8051, the port 3 signal, pin number 10 and pin number 11. Pin number 10 is a P3.0, which is also act as RXD, and pin number 11 is our P3.1, which is act as a TXD. Yes, you remember, friends. So, for a serial communication in 8051, it took the help of two signals. One is a transmit data TXD, and the other one is receive data RXD. In addition to this, it took the help of three internal registers. One is a serial control register SBUF, and another one is serial buffer register SBUF, and last one is power control register PCON. So these are three registers are involving in serial communication in case of 8051 microcontroller. Totally, to do a serial communication in 8051 with the help of a serial port, it took the help of two signals. One is a TXD and another one is RXD. And it took the help of three internal registers. One is SCON serial control register, and number two is SBUF serial buffer register, and third one is a PCON power control register. Now we'll go and see one by one. Next, the first one is serial buffer register SBUF. So serial buffer register is an 8-bit register, that is number one, and it is a byte addressable register, and its internal address is 99H. That means we can access this SBUF register in our programming by using its name SBUF or by using its internal address 99H. So it is not a bit addressable, it is byte addressable. That means entire register have only one address, that was 99H. And coming to the second point, the register serial buffer register is used to hold the data. So the name itself indicates serial buffer register. Buffer job is it can hold the data. So the job of serial buffer register is it is used to hold the data which is going to use in our serial communication. That means if your controller want to transfer a data to an external device in a serial form, the data is initially stored in SBUF, or second thing, it receives the data from any external device in serial form, the received data first stored in SBUF. So the job of a serial buffer register is it can hold a data. So that is this. The register SBUF is physically two registers. It is not a single register. So why? Because your 8051 supports a full duplex serial communication. That means at any time your controller transfer a data as well as receives a data. If it is a transfer a data with the help of a TXD signal, and it receives the data with the help of a RXD signal. For better understanding, I can go for this. Let you assume, friends, this is my serial port. So this is a serial port 8051 microcontroller. So this is whole thing RE051. So in that, this is my serial port. This serial port have a two partitions. One partition we can call as transmitter section, TX. And another partition we can call as receiver section, RS. This is a transmitter section and this is a receiver section. So transmitter section always transmit a data to an external device by using a signal called TXD transmitted data. So in this case, here there is a serial buffer register SBUF. Only the content of serial buffer register SBUF is a transfer to an external device with the help of TXD. And similarly, our serial port collects the data from an external device in serial form by using a signal called RXD. So the receive data again stored in another SBUF register which was present in receiver section. So if you are observing this, there are two serial buffer registers present physically in 8051 microcontroller. But important thing is, for these two SBUF registers, we are using only common address, that was 99H. That means I am not going to assign one more address to another SBUF register that was present either in the transmitter section or it is in a receiver section. For these two SBUF registers, we are allocating only one internal register, one internal address, that was 99H. So that is the meaning of that. See here, friends, the register SBUF is physically two registers. One is a write-only. Write-only in the sense, this is. Because it always receives the data from external device through RXD. The receive data written onto this SBUF. So this SBUF is always a write-only SBUF register. Because always some data was written onto this. So, and it is used to hold the data transmitted out of the 8051. Sorry. So this is not a write-only, this is a write-only. Sorry guys, this is a write-only because from controller point of view, we write something onto this. We write something onto this, from this the data is a transfer. And coming to another one is a read-only, that means your controller point of view, it always reads the data. So this is our read-only SBUF register. It is used to read the data from an external device by using a signal called RXD. So this is a write-only SBUF register and this is read-only SBUF register. So both the registers have only one common address, which is 99H. So that's what I am written here. The other is read-only and holds the received data from the external sources via RXD. Both mutually exclusive registers have the same address, that was 99H. Yes. Next coming to another important register that was present in our 8051 serial port was serial control register SCOM. Again it is also an 8-bit register, but it is a bit addressable register. That means each and every bit of this SCOM register have again its own individual address. So for entire SCOM register the address is 98H. And again, if you go for each and every bit of that, again, each and everyone has its own internal address. We can access those bits separately also. So, it is a bit addressable register and whose internal address is 98H. If you go for SBUF, its internal address is 99H, but it is 98H. So, the name itself indicates a serial control register. So, this register is used to control our serial communication. By selection of mode of operation, by using some of the bits of this SCOM register, we select the mode of operation of our serial port, as well as we can enable a receiver section of 8051 serial port whenever we want. And also, the serial communication interrupt flags also present in this SCOM register. So, see here, this is the structure of our SCOM register. So, in this case, SM0, SM1, these are two we can call as serial mode selection bits. Serial mode selection bits, to which you are able to get four different combinations. That is SM0, SM1. So here SM0 is present in the most significant size, so that you have to always consider SM0 is MSB. So 2 bits, 4 combinations. 00, 01, 10 and then 11. 00 case we can call as mode 0 operation. And 01 case we can call mode 1 operation. And 10 case mode 2 operation. 11 case mode 3 operation. Like this. There are 4 different modes. The mode selection we select with the help of mode selection bits which are present in serial control register at MSB side, that is SM0 and SM1. And next coming to a bit D4 is called REN. REN means receive enable or receiver enable. So by making of this bit is just set to 1, then and only our serial port receiver section is ready to receive the data from an external device by using RX2. I repeat once again, if this REN is equal to 1, that means the receiver section what we have in a serial port that was enabled, then and only your serial port receives the data from an external device by using RXD signal. If you make this REN is equal to 0, your receiver section was disabled the time your 8051 can't receive any data from an external device by using RXD. So that is the use of this REN. Next, TB8 means a transmit bit number 8. Transmit bit number 8. If you go for the modes of operation of our 8051 serial port, we have two different modes, that is the 9-bit UART modes are present. 9 bits in the sense, 8 bits are data bits which are present in our SBUF register. And 9th bit is nothing but that is a TB8. So this TB8 is used as a 9th bit when our serial port transfer data to an external device by using a TXD signal in a mode 2 and mode 3 operations. In a mode 2, mode 3 operations, our serial port is act as a 9-bit UART modes. At the time, the total number of data bits we are transferring or receiving was a 9 bits. 8 bits are SBUF register bits. Actually, accumulator bits are transferred to SBUF. Then accumulator size is an 8 bit and SBUF register size is an 8 bit. And the 9th bit is a nothing but TB8. So, this TB8 is a 9th bit which is used to transfer a data to an external device by using TXD in mode 2 and mode 3 operations, because those two are 9-bit UART modes. In a similarly, RB8 means receive bit number 8. In a mode 2 and mode 3, those two are the 9-bit UART modes. The received 8 bits are stored, first 8 bits are stored in SBUF. The 9th bit what it receives from an external device by using RXD, that was stored in RB8. The 9th bit received bit was stored in RB8. So don't confuse your friends. If you go for a register point of view, we can say that bit number in D0, D1, D2 like that. So D0 to D7 we consider as an 8 bits and D8 is considered as 9th bit. But if you start from bit number 1, 1 to 8 we are considering as first 8 bits and 9th bit is nothing but our bit which is stored in this RB8 in the case of receiving the data. So RB8 is nothing but a receive bit number 9, bit number 8. That means 9th bit what we are receiving in mode 2 and mode 3 operations of our signal. And next, TI means transmit interrupt. TI means transmit interrupt. This bit is automatically set whenever our serial port transmitter section SBUF register was empty. I repeat, this transmit interrupt is automatically set whenever the serial port transmitter section SBUF register was empty. Or I can say in another way, whenever the serial port successfully transfer a data from a transmitter section to an external device by using a TXD signal, then this TI bit is set to 1. That indicates to the central processing unit of our controller that the transmitter section successfully transfer the data. So do you have any other data I would like to transfer to the same device? You can send your data to me. That is the meaning is provided by STI. And similarly, RI means receive interrupt. Once a receiver section successfully receives the data from an external device, that means the internal SBUF register of receiver section full with the data. So that time, this receive interrupt is automatically set. So that gives the indication to central processing unit that it receives a successfully data from an external device in serial form, so that the SBUF register present in a receiver section was full with the data. So go and accept the data. Otherwise, what happens is, if still an external device sent further data to the receiver section of a serial port, the newly received data overwritten on existing one. So it will give that information to our central processing unit of 8051 by activation of this RI. So the combination of transmit interrupt and receive interrupt we can call as serial port interrupt SI. If you remember interrupt concept, the time I clearly told you guys, you took an OR gate output we consider as serial port interrupt. This OR gate have a two inputs. One is a transmit interrupt ADI, another one is a receive interrupt RI. If any one of these are set to 1, automatically SI is set to 1. If both are set to 1, then also SI is set to 1. So that is the meaning of TI as well as RI. So next, coming to another one. So this is what I can say about modes of operation. SM0, SM1, 00 case mode 0, 01 case mode 1, 10 case mode 2, 11 case mode 3. Here I would like to extend some more. So mode 0 operation we can also call a shift register mode. Mode 0 operation what we can also call is shift register mode. Mode 1 is called 8-bit UART mode. And 10 case is called a 9-bit UART mode. And 11 case also called a 9-bit UART mode. In previously when I was explaining about a TB8 and RB8, TB8 is nothing but a bit number 9 which we are transmitting to an external device by using THC. And RB8 is nothing but that is a bit number 9 which was receiving from an external device in case of mode 2 and mode 3 operations, because mode 2 and mode 3 are 9-bit UART modes. If you are observing these modes, guys, mode 1, mode 2 and mode 3 are UART modes. UART means universal asynchronous receiver and transmitter. Asynchronous receiver and transmitter. So that is the full form of our UART. That means mode 1, 2, 3 are asynchronous serial communication modes. But where we have a serial communication mode? You remember, friends, mode 0 we consider as a synchronous serial communication mode. Why? Because synchronous serial communication mode. Why? Because if you go and take a shift register, in a shift register, we are applying the clock signals to all the flip-flops which are present in that shift register simultaneously. But coming to asynchronous, the clock is not applied to all the registers simultaneously, all the flip-flops simultaneously which are present in a register. So you remember, friends, mode 1, 2, 3 we consider as asynchronous serial communication modes, and the first one is considered as synchronous serial communication modes. In every serial communication, the speed of operation of serial communication we measured in terms of a baud rate. In serial communication, we measured the speed of operation in terms of baud rate. Baud rate means the number of bits transferred or received per second. The number of bits per second. How many number of bits we transfer in a second? Or how many number of bits we receive in a second? That called a baud rate. So, for serial communication, the baud rate is F oscillator divided by 12. And already told you why this is a 12 was present. The reason for this is, for a machine cycle, it will take total 12 clock cycles. If you remember our timer control logic circuit, oscillator produces frequencies or passes through and divided by 12 is circuit. So that, for mode 0 operation or synchronous serial communication mode of operation, the baud rate is f oscillator divided by 12 itself. But coming to mode 1, it is a variable. That means we can calculate the baud rate of a mode 1 operation of serial port with the help of a timers. With the help of a timers, we can calculate the baud rate, so that here the baud rate was variable. And coming to mode 2, the mode of operation is 9-bit UART mode, there is no doubt at all. It is same as mode 3, but the difference where we are getting is the baud rate. For mode 2, the baud rate was constant, either it is f oscillator divided by 32 or it is f oscillator divided by 64. But coming to again mode 3, the baud rate was variable. So this is the modes of operation. And coming to the last register, that is power control register, PCON. The 9 is related to power, but how it is related to a serial communication? In entire this power control register, only one bit that was related to serial communication, which is the most significant bit, S1. Only this is the bit that was related to serial communication. If this S1 bit is set to 1, what happens is, the time what is the baud rate that is going on in our serial port, that automatically doubles. I repeat, once S1 is set to 1, the serial communication baud rate was doubles. That means, in order to increase the speed of operation of your serial port, either in a transmission of a data or receiving of a data, we took the help of a bit called S1. If S1 is set to 0, whatever the baud rate that is continuing in our serial port, that is as it is. If you want to change it, you make S1 is set to 1. Coming to the remaining bits, what we have in this power control register is 3 bits are not defined, and next to GF1 and GF0, basically these two are the user defined flags. Once you remember, friends, the features of 8051 microcontroller. So that time we clearly told you that our 8051 supports 4 mathematical flags, our 4 conditional flags, our 4 status flags, along with 3 user defined flags. Those 3 user defined flags, if not present in PSW, and remind you, 2 more user defined flags are present in power control register PCON, that is GF1 and GF0. That means I can go and set the usage of this GF1 as well as GF0. That means I'll go and define for what case GF1 is set to 1, for what case GF0 is set to 1, for what cases GF1 and GF0 becomes 0. That I was decided. That means the user was decided. So that these are 2 we consider as user defined facts. And next, coming to 2 more bits, that is PD and IDL. These are 2 are related to power saving modes. Again, if you refer the features of 8051 microcontroller, that is, it will support 2 power saving modes. That means in order to save the power consumption of the controller, we can operate our controller in 2 different modes. One is the idle mode and second one is power down mode. So, in order to operate our controller either in idle mode, that time I took the help of idle bit of power control register, and if I want to operate my controller in power down mode, then I took the help of PD bit in power control register. Now, I would like to give more information about idle mode as well as power down mode. Once you make this ideal is equal to 1, no doubt our controller is enters into idle mode. In idle mode, your controller can't do anything. That means the central processing unit of your controller sit idle. That means originally it didn't get a clock signal to central processing unit from an oscillator circuit. Once your central processing unit can't get a clock signal from an oscillator circuit, it can't proceed further, because your central processing unit is a synchronous device. It can do different automatic operations or logical operations or branching operations. All these things are performed by our central processing unit with the reference to clock. Once our 8051 operates in idle mode, what happens is your central processing unit sits idle. Why? Because you can't get a clock signal from an oscillator circuit. That means the path between your oscillator circuit and central processing unit was operated in tri-state. That means it was a logically disconnected state. Once your CPU was not in operated condition, automatically the power consumption of your controller was decreases. But the rest of the devices what we have in 8051, like maybe timer circuits or a serial port, or it's maybe our interrupt circuits, all these things get a clock signal except our central processing unit. So that the power consumption of your CPU, your controller was decreases once it was operated in idle mode. So coming to the second one is P, that means power down. In a power down mode, we can save much more power compared to idle mode. Compared to idle mode, we can save much more power once our 8051 was operates in power down mode. Why? Because in case of power down mode, the clock signal can't go to anywhere of your controller. That means ideally your oscillator circuits was disabled. Logically it was disabled. That means it generated clock signal can't go to anywhere of your controller. It can't send a control clock signal to counters. It can't send a clock signal to the serial port. It can't send the clock signal to interrupt circuits. It can't send the clock signal to internal central processing unit. So that all the components of your 8051 microcontroller are sit idle. They didn't get a clock pulse, so that they can't proceed further, so that the power consumption of your controller is a further decreases. So we have a two power saving modes. In order to operate our 8051, either of these are two modes, we took the help of a register called power control register. In that we are using two least significant bits. Least significant bit is idle bit. By making of that bit equal to 1, our controller is enters into idle mode. The next bit is the PD, means power down mode bit. If you make that bit is equal to 1, our controller is enters into power down mode. So this is about the power control register. So I hope you understand the concept of serial communication and what are the different signals are participating in it, and what are the different registers are involving in it, and we are gone through each and every register and their bits and their functionality. So thank you for patient listening. We will meet in the next class. Thank you for once again patient listening.